When defining any problem, one of the first things we have to do is set the parameters or assumptions with which we're going to work. While there are many reasons for doing this, some of the most basic are obvious. Here are a few. Unless we limit the scope of a problem, it becomes difficult to determine what the results tell us. In most systems, there are too many variables to comprehensively solve a system in an efficient manner. Or before we do a detailed analysis of a system, it's best to get a reasonable estimate of its behavior. This is the first step in checking our eventual results. This is how we first approached operational amplifiers. We stated a list of ideal assumptions, and using those assumptions, we analyzed the behavior of the circuit containing the op-amp. We all know, however, that nothing is ideal or perfect. In this video, we'll take a look at some of the limitations of operational amplifiers. Let's begin by reviewing our previous assumptions about operational amplifiers. The basic ideal assumptions about operational amplifiers are they have infinite input resistance, therefore no input current. They have infinite open loop gain, resulting in no difference in electric potential between the input pins. They have no output resistance, meaning the output can source or sink any current necessary to make the circuit work. Most of the time, these are pretty good assumptions. But it does not take a lot of playing around with operational amplifiers to discover that they are less than perfect. We will take a look at the limitations of these assumptions in a little bit, but let's start with the first non-ideality that we're likely to encounter. The limitation we are most likely to run into at the outset when working with op-amps is saturation. As an electrical engineer, I want to use the phrase non-linear transfer characteristic here. While true, this may be overcomplicating what is occurring. An operational amplifier can amplify an input signal because of the DC power that is being supplied. The output of an operational amplifier becomes saturated when we try to force the output signal to be larger than the DC potential or voltage that is being supplied to the power of the circuit. Conservation of energy, specifically stated as Kirchhoff's voltage law, tells us this should be an expected limitation. What this means is this. Let's say we have a sinusoidal input to our operational amplifier circuit that amplifies the input signal by a factor of about 20 volts per volt. Let's also say that our DC power supplies are set to plus and minus 10 volts. If the amplitude of the input is small enough so that the output does not exceed a few volts peak, we see the input being multiplied by a factor of 20 volts per volt. If we increase the input of the amplitude so the output would ideally be 10 volts peak, however, we see the peaks of the output wave are flattened or clipped. Because of some internal losses of the operational amplifier, the clipping occurs just below the DC power supplies. The limitation we are calling saturation simply means the output amplitude of the operational amplifier circuit cannot be greater than the power supplies. This is probably not a great surprise to anyone, but it is something that is easily overlooked because we analyze the signal characteristics of the amplifier separate from the DC condition. This is an application of superposition. When we analyze the signal characteristics of an operational amplifier circuit on paper, we have to check to make sure the output voltage does not exceed or even equal the DC power supplies. If it does, we have to at least note that the output signal will have the top and bottom cut off. We had a couple of ideal properties that were prefixed with the term infinite. Anytime a scientist or engineer is using the term infinite, all they really mean is very large. Unless, of course, they mean very small, as in infinitesimal. There is no such thing as a physical infinity. Philosophers can doodle with words all they want. Anytime anything approaching infinity happens, physics breaks. And not in a humorous way. One of the infinities we supposed was an infinite open loop gain. While the open loop gain may be very large, it is definitely not infinite. To see how this affects the behavior of an operational amplifier circuit, let's use the model of an operational amplifier circuit only taking into account the finite gain of the dependent source. If we put this model into an inverting amplifier circuit, it's quite clear that the voltage at the non-inverting terminal of the amplifier is still zero because it's grounded. This means that the output voltage of the amplifier can be written as Vout equals the negative of the open loop gain times the voltage at the inverting terminal. If this equation is true, and it is, we can solve this equation for the voltage at the inverting terminal, and we discover that the voltage is non-zero. Asserting this voltage at the inverting terminal, we can write a note equation. After a few quick algebraic manipulations of the equation, we can arrange it so that the ratio of the output voltage to the input voltage can be expressed like this. Let's take a look at the resultant equation. We notice that if the open loop gain of the operational amplifier is infinite, then the non-ideal term in the bottom of the equation becomes zero, and the equation reduces to the ideal output equation for an inverting amplifier. On the other hand, if we put in reasonable values into this equation, we discover that this effect only becomes significant if the gain of our amplifier is very large or the open loop gain of the operational amplifier is very small. A fairly large resistor ratio might be 100. Then an open loop gain as low as 10,000 volts per volt results in only a 1% decrease from the ideal output. If you have spent some time building circuits on breadboards in the laboratory using standard 5% tolerance resistors, you know that a 1% error is not only acceptable, but it's probably good enough to celebrate. Another infinity we use in our ideal model is an infinite input resistance. This is the property from which we derive the secondary ideal characteristic of no current entering the input terminals of the operational amplifier. I'm not going to do a detailed analysis of the effect of finite input resistance. Instead, I'll talk about it in terms of practical considerations. Almost every operational amplifier on the market has an input resistance of at least 100 kiloohms or larger, with many of them having input resistances in the giga or even teraohm range. The result of this are input bias currents that range from tens of microamps down to nanoamps and below. What this means in a practical sense for us at the introductory level is that we must choose our resistors so that the equivalent resistance connected to the input terminal is much less than the input resistance of the operational amplifier. This will minimize the effect that the finite input resistance has on the output of our amplifier circuit. For most operational amplifiers, this will not be much of a constraint, but for certain amplifiers, we may have to limit our input resistors to the low kiloohm range. At the other end of the operational amplifier, we have the output resistance. In the ideal assumption, we assume this value is 0 ohms. In reality, this resistance is not 0 ohms, however, it is very small. Again, for almost every operational amplifier on the market, this value will be below 100 ohms. What this means for us in a practical sense is that the resistors connected to the output terminal must be much greater than the output resistance for us to neglect the effects of the output resistor. If we're talking about an output resistance of 100 ohms, then we're talking about load resistors on the order of 1 kiloohm or larger. Another way to think about the limitation of the output would be to realize that the output cannot source or sink any value of current, but is limited to a certain range of currents. For most operational amplifiers, as long as the output current of the op amp is less than plus or minus 10 milliamps, this limitation can be neglected. There are a couple of other pins on the operational amplifier chip that we have not really talked about. The offset null pins. To talk about these in a slightly meaningful way, let's remember the internal circuitry of the operational amplifier is fairly complex. With this complexity comes a possibility of small imperfections in the circuit. If everything in the internal input stage of the amplifier is not perfectly matched, you can think of it as a slight lack of symmetry, the characteristics of the two input terminals may be slightly different. And when I say slightly, I mean slightly. The two input pins, for example, might have a couple of millivolts of difference between them, or the already small current into the terminals might be different by fractions of microamps. Other slight imperfections within the operational amplifier may also result in an unwanted voltage at the output even when there is no input. The offset null pins are there so we can make an adjustment that sets the output voltage to zero when there's no input signal to the operational amplifier. This adjustment is made by connecting a potentiometer between the offset null pins. A potentiometer is a resistor that has a third arm called a wiper arm. By adjusting the potentiometer, often by turning a dial, the wiper arm can be used to select a portion of the total resistance. This allows us to have a variable resistance between the wiper arm and either end of the potentiometer, or to have a variable voltage divider between the ends and the wiper arm. To use a potentiometer to correct for an offset, the potentiometer is connected between the offset null terminals of the op amp, and the wiper arm of the potentiometer is tied to the negative power supply. A potentiometer is then adjusted until there's no voltage at the output. There may be a model of operational amplifier out there that does this slightly differently, so you should always read through the datasheet before connecting a component to ensure its proper usage. The last non-ideality we're going to touch on today is slew rate. The slew rate of an operational amplifier is the maximum possible rate of change of the voltage at the output. Formally, it could be written like this. So if the output signal were a sine wave, we could take the derivative of the output and determine the combination of frequency and voltage magnitude that the circuit can handle. For example, the 741 operational amplifier has a slew rate of 0.5 volts per microsecond. So if the output has a 3 volt peak, the maximum frequency of the output signal would be about 26.5 kilohertz. To see what slew rate limiting looks like, we can turn the frequency up on the operational amplifier circuit we were working with before. I have turned it well past the initial stages of slew rate limiting so that the effect is very obvious. What we see happening is when the sine wave at the output changes at a rate faster than the output can handle, The slope of the output signal is limited to the slew rate, making our sine wave look more like a triangle wave. Now, I want to be clear, we have not exhaustively covered the non-idealities of an operational amplifier, nor have we done detailed analyses of them. On the other hand, I want to make sure that we understand that as long as the operational amplifiers are used within a reasonable window of operation, they do behave relatively ideally. Things that are outside the reasonable window of operation include trying to make the output exceed the DC power supplies, trying to get an extraordinary amount of gain from an operational amplifier circuit, using too large of resistors surrounding the operational amplifier, trying to connect too small of a resistor to the output of the operational amplifier, or trying to get a lot of gain out of the circuit at a high frequency. As long as we keep these things in mind, we can use operational amplifiers analyzing or designing our circuits with the ideal assumptions. That's all for today. Go out and make it a great one.